morning, everybody. My name's Mark Patterson, and I'm coming to you live from 20,000 millimeters under the sea. I'm in America's inner space station called Aquarius, and this is an educational outreach project of the Living Oceans Foundation called Project Sea Camel. Today is classroom 5 out of 6 classrooms that we're doing live from Conch Reef, which is in the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary. And we're down here today to do an interesting classroom on motion in the ocean. If you go to the Living Oceans website, which is seacamel.livingoceansfoundation.org, you'll see the lesson plan for today. For those of you who have tuned in for the first time, this is an experiment to do college-level teaching using the world's only underwater laboratory. And today we're going to be looking at the physics of motion in the ocean. We've had 4 previous modules that have focused on the engineering of living underwater and why scientists come to use Aquarius. And we've had several modules on the biology of the corals and the other marvelous fish and invertebrates that live here at Conch Reef. But today we thought we'd do something a little bit different. Now, this will be a somewhat challenging class to teach, but it's also something that experientially we can't do any other way. In order to understand how the motion moves and how it affects the lives of all the plants and animals that live in it, you really have to go into it and observe it. So this module is going to do just that. Now I need to introduce a couple of concepts here, and our crack shore team of Scott Monroe and Dominic Landucci has some images that they're going to show you. The first one I'd like to show you is something that affects everything on Earth, and that's a boundary layer. A boundary layer forms over any surface in nature, including all the plants and animals that live here at Conch Reef. It also forms over you when you step outside your house and go for a walk in the air. What is a boundary layer exactly? Well, the diagram shows a boundary layer over a kelp blade. And what it is it's a layer of slower moving water that forms. As you move away from the surface of the object, the flow moves faster and faster and faster. Right at the surface of the object, there is no motion whatsoever. So actually out on Conch Reef where our aquanauts are, the water is actually stuck to the entire bottom of the ocean. And that really wasn't appreciated by scientists until the early 1900s. And it's got a name that fluid mechanics call it. It's called the no-slip condition of fluid mechanics. So everything is stuck using molecular bonds. And then when you go the next layer further away, you get a slightly increased motion past the surface. And then when you go a little bit further, the flow goes faster until finally you reach something called mainstream flow. Now, what's the relevance of this gradient in velocity over individual organisms? Well, that boundary layer is actually a barrier. It's a barrier for the transfer of materials. It's a barrier of diffusion to get materials into the organism or from the organism back into the environment. But we also have boundary layers forming over the whole planet. And if we could go to the next image, we're going to see a picture of what is known as a geophysical boundary layer looks like. There's a picture of a house, and we can see the same velocity profile we saw over the kelp developed. But this is a boundary layer that exists at a really big scale. So while the boundary layer over an individual creature might be as small as a centimeter or two, this boundary layer over a coral reef might extend many meters, and in the deeper ocean, tens of meters, and in air, these boundary layers can extend maybe a kilometer or more in height. Now, why do we care about these gradients in velocity? Well, we already mentioned they're a barrier to diffusion and movement of materials into the organism and from the organism back into the environment. Previously at Aquarius, we've discovered that these movements of water past the surfaces of corals actually affect processes like respiration and photosynthesis. They're also important for dispersing eggs and sperm during spawning events, and also for the dispersal of the larval or juvenile phases of a whole host of reef creatures. So it's important that we understand how the water is moving around the reef. We've got a little movie showing you how complex the movement of water can be. And this is a computer animation of flow past a little obstacle in a boundary layer. And if you're watching the animation, you'll be able to see, and this is on the Living Oceans website as well, you'll be able to see something called a turbulent eddy forming on the downstream side of the object. And these eddies spin up and they go blowing up into the boundary layer. And you'll notice that this induces a lot of mixing in the vertical direction normal to the surface of the earth, whether it's underwater or air, makes no difference. Now, how are we going to see what these boundary layers actually look like? Well, we're going to use a couple of tools, one of them low-tech and one of them high-tech. The low-tech tool is one that we actually used when we were investigating sponges yesterday. And we're going to use dye being released into the boundary layer. We're going to release dye into the boundary layer and look at the mixing of the dye so that we can actually see what these eddies, these spinning packets of water, are doing. And then we're going to use a high-tech tool called a dissolved oxygen profiler. This is a device we used yesterday when we were looking at sponge bioenergetics. We actually use this device to measure the respiration rate of sponges, but we can also use it to measure how much oxygen there is out on the reef in general, which is a good measure of water quality. Everything needs oxygen for its metabolism, or most creatures do here on the reef. And we've got a picture, I believe, that we can show you of what you'll be seeing later in this broadcast. Captain Phil Renault, who's the executive director of the Living Oceans Foundation and one of our aquanauts, is going to be using this profiler. And at this point, actually, I'd like to introduce my two fellow aquanauts outside that are part of the science team. Captain Phil Renault is the executive director of the Living Oceans Foundation. Living Oceans Foundation is a not-for-profit organization based in Maryland, and it's dedicated to marine science and conservation with a special emphasis on coral reefs. They're the sponsor of this classroom experience. And with him is Dr. Annalise Hagen, who's chief project scientist for the foundation. She's an expert on corals and did her PhD at Cambridge University. So you'll notice a slight British accent when we go to her. And I know that you guys are outside now near Aquarius, I think out in the sand. So I'd like to ask Phil to explain what he's holding there and how that device works. He's also got a piece of PVC piping that I'd like him to explain. And then Annalise is going to show the lower tech tool, the dye syringe. And then we'll explain a little more about turbulence back here in a minute. So, Phil, what do you have out there that you're going to be using today?
Well, good morning, everyone. Phil Renault here out on sand flats outside of the aquarium habitat. This is day three of our underwater classroom mission. And I have a device here that was
Apparently there's a problem with his mic, so could you explain to us how the dissolved oxygen profiler works?
Okay.
And why we have logarithmic spacing on the stand there, or I can explain that inside when you guys are done showing
us. Okay, well, we got as far as showing, we've shown the actual profiling unit itself, and then here on the top, you'll see a sensor through this small hole. So when the water passes through this hole, the sensor here will record the amount of dissolved oxygen that's in the water column. If we look over here to the right, we can see our profiling stand. And it has measurement segments on it, but you'll notice that they're not individually spaced. This is called a logarithmic scale, and this is because when you're looking to take measurements in the boundary layer, it's not an even spacing. the spacings are further apart. So what we're going to do later in the show is to take dissolved oxygen readings at all these different spacings through the water column. We're also going to be using these dye syringes to show the direction of flow and how water moves differently over different substrates. So looking at flow over sand, where we are now, and over the coral reef. Mark, do you want to add anything there?
No, that's a good point for me to explain something new to the classes that are out there. Motion in the ocean is complex, Annalise, and we need to understand a concept called turbulence to fully appreciate what's going on. Now, turbulence is still a deep mystery to the physicists as to why it arises, but we have some good qualitative understanding of how these spinning packets of eddies work. And if we could show Dominic and Scott, we've got a movie there on shore that maybe we could run. It's the it's dye moving over the surface of a coral. It was shot at night, and we can see some of these spinning packets of water moving back and forth over the surface of the coral. We can see that the mixing occurs in many different directions. So these eddies are causing movement of dissolved substances like oxygen or carbon dioxide in all directions very efficiently. At this point, though, I need to explain to you a little bit about diffusion, and I do have to use an equation, but since this is university-level teaching, we shouldn't be afraid of some simple algebra, so I'm going to do a little bit of gorilla cam work here. We've got to take the camera off the stand for a second. You've had a nice view down the habitat today, the length of the habitat, so you can get some appreciation of its size. And we'll see if the focus is okay here. Okay, I'm going to focus in here for a second here. Okay, this is a very important equation for biology. What's the concept of flux? Flux is the movement of some goodie, something the organism wants, into its body, or in the case of something it wants to get rid of, like nitrogen products, like ammonia or urea, out of its body. And what's it equal to? Well, it's a simple product of the diffusivity of the material that's moving times a concentration gradient. And to actually look at what we're going to measure out on the reef, a flux is the amount of something that moves in the surfaces, say, of the corals per unit time, and the dimensions of the diffusivity for, say, something like oxygen are actually something a little bit counterintuitive. It's actually measured in area squared or length squared. And then we've got on the gradient how much we've got dissolved per unit volume and how far that moves into the organism. Now, what's important to note is that this diffusivity up here can be either a molecular diffusivity, and that's what happens inside your lungs as oxygen goes into your lungs, where it's moving over a very microscopic distance, or in the ocean, we can have these spinning packets of water move them around through the action of turbulence. And what's interesting about this notion of diffusivity is that it is orders of magnitude faster. That means powers of 10 faster than molecular diffusivity. So to give you a concrete example of this, when the oxygen comes into my lungs here, as I'm sitting here in Aquarius, and it diffuses into my bloodstream, it only has to move a distance of a few millionths of a meter, and that takes place in a split second. But out on the reef, if there's some egg and sperm that need to come together during a coral reef spawning event, that process may take many seconds to many minutes to occur, but it can occur at a much larger scale. We're talking the scale of meters or tens of meters, and it's much more energetic and faster. And we're going to get a view of that using the dye that Annalise has out there. So the first thing I'd like to ask Annalise to do is to figure out which direction the current is going. And then what she's going to do is she's going to release dye at several different heights. And our cameraman, DJ Roller, who's behind the lens, is going to hold very still as she does this. He's not going to move the camera so that we can look at how the dye blob behaves. And here's what I'd like you to watch back in the classroom. I want you to observe, and I'm going to have Annalise comment on this, whether or not the dye diffuses evenly or whether it has a preferred direction. And is that direction vertical or horizontal? So first, Annalise, I'd like you to figure out which way is motion in the ocean today at Concrete.
Okay, I'm going to take my dye syringe and just squirt a little bit into the water column to check which way the current is flowing. Shown the dye being squirted out.
Thank you very much, Annalise. That was great. I wish I could have seen exactly what you were seeing. I did want to ask you folks to set up the logarithmic stand for the next part. And while you're doing that, I have a little clarification. I'm going to use the gorilla camera again. One side effect of teaching at 2.5 atmospheres is nitrogen has a mild narcotic effect. And I realized that I accidentally put up the wrong slide, which was created last night in the wee hours of the morning. And I didn't put up the one I'd done this morning with the correct dimensions on our flux equation. So let me revisit some of that. And then I also want to explain a little bit about what you just saw and a very important difference between molecular diffusion and turbulent diffusion on the reef. So getting back to this flux equation, the movement of something into the organism or into the seafloor is the product of a diffusion coefficient and a concentration gradient. So the amount coming in per unit surface area per time is the product of this constant, which has dimensions of length squared, and it's also a product of the concentration gradient, which is how much of the stuff we have per unit volume over a certain distance. Now, the interesting part about this in the ocean is this diffusivity is almost always a turbulent diffusivity. And you just saw turbulent diffusion in action when Annalise released the little blobs of dye. And what you saw is that this diffusivity depends on direction, either up and down or side to side. You also may have noticed, and if you didn't, we'll have another opportunity to see this again in a few minutes on the other side of the habitat. You also may have noticed that as time went on and the dye blob got bigger and bigger, it actually got mixed more and more efficiently. So in essence, the diffusivity was speeding up as the experiment went on. In other words, this is a constant when it's inside the body or at very small scales, but in nature, this is no longer a constant and it changes with time. And we're going to look at that time change in a little more detail in a second. Now, at this point, I'd actually like to take an Ask an Aquanaut question that came in via email, and I'm going to put the camera back on the stand. And I just checked email, Annalise, and we've got a question from a geology student, Lindsay, at the Virginia Institute of Marine Science. And she wants to know, well, if you're so interested in measuring mixing on a coral reef, what would be a way to get a view of mixing at a big scale, given that coral reefs are such huge structures? What would be the What are some of the ways that you might go about doing that? And if Phil is able to participate in this, should we try potting him up as well? Because Captain Renault is actually an oceanographer in a previous life, and he knows a lot about physics of the Earth's boundary layer because part of his job was giving the Navy really good data on wind and weather and ocean currents on the entire planet. So let's see if they can have a little conversation about that.
Well, that's a very interesting question. And the Navy has done quite a bit of research and effort into instrumenting the oceans in order to understand all of the variability that occurs out here. So, if I was to approach this problem, I would first look at some sampling to determine the scales of the variability out here. First, have to understand that we need to measure things on a very small scale, or are we able to spread out our sensors and still effectively measure the phenomena that we're working on? One way to do it is to use an acoustic current Doppler profiler. works in the same way as any Doppler sensor, where you can measure changes over heights, over distances. This is how sound travels through the water and the variability you can measure in that. So for instance, set up a number of these acoustic Doppler current profilers around the reef here, and then you can network that together and have these simultaneous measurements of how the current changes with height and with distance. And that would be quite a sophisticated way to set up an ocean observing system around Conch Reef here at the Aquarius Habitat. Now, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration has recently set up a sophisticated observing system here at Conch Reef that measures a wide variety of different ocean variables, measuring things like temperature and currents and chemical properties of the water. And anybody can access that over the NOAA website. Annalise, what else would you do to approach this problem?
Well, I think the methods that we've been showing today, using the dye, that's a very low-tech method. But if you were to automate the process and maybe stage a series of dye dispersion through the water column, then you could see how flow was changing near the seabed and further away from the seabed. I think for now we're going to use the logarithmic scale that we have in front of us to do some dissolved oxygen measurements. So if you want to take the measurements, I'll write down the numbers for you.
Okay. I'm going to start right at the bottom of the scale here. The first reading I have is 17.78. Now, this changes only very slightly. I just moved it up to the second rung. The reading just changed to 17.77. I now move up to the third rung. And it's staying constant right now at 17.77. Sensor settle out now. 17.79 is the next reading. And it's staying steady there, so I'll move up to the next rung. It actually dropped back to 17.78 here. More difficult as I have to get my voice a little bit better here. Okay, the next reading is steady at 17.79. As we go higher in the water column, the sensor pressure is quite steady now, 17.79. And I also have to go all the way up at the top. And we'll see if we can get a little bit of air in here. And then we'll let it settle out right here. And I'm reporting that it is 17.79.
This is very interesting. We've done these experiments before at Aquarius. Back in 2003, 2004, we did a couple hundred of these profiles around Conch Reef. And you've actually seen something today that we have only observed a few times, and that is you've got a pretty even distribution of oxygen over the bottom 2 meters. Now, part of that may be, are you folks over a sand plain right now? Okay, so you don't have a lot of biology nearby potentially affecting that. But I did notice yesterday that we had quite a bit of wave action, and we also had an underwater mixing event called an internal wave that came in and really mixed the water column up. So the fact that you've got a nice uniform distribution of oxygen is quite unusual. It's normally we're seeing big changes over short distances in dissolved oxygen. So I'd actually want you folks to go and move yourself on the opposite side of the habitat in the flow direction. And we had an idea when we came to set up these classrooms that we asked ourselves, is it possible that Aquarius is such a big structure that it could have an effect on the water chemistry nearby? And why did we think it was possible that this could happen? Well, we've got an image that Annalise took. It's image 5.3 that she took this summer when we were getting ready for these classrooms. And it shows all the encrusting invertebrates, which are sponges and corals and soft corals that live on the habitat. And these invertebrates attract huge schools of fish, which is going to be the subject of our classroom this afternoon. Well, since we've got all this biomass here, and since all life on Earth needs oxygen to respire, is it possible that the biomass that hangs out near Aquarius might have an effect on the water column chemistry? So we're going to have Annalise and Phil move over to the other side of the habitat. Previously, we've seen some really weird profiles here. I'm not sure. I think Dominic and Scott have a movie of this. If they don't, I can just describe in words what we've seen in the past. We call it the dance of the oxygen profile. And what we've seen is that over the distance from the floor here to about as tall as I am, we can get some drastic changes in dissolved oxygen. Now, this is not something that was expected to happen on a coral reef. The accepted view of coral reef was that there was sort of vigorous mixing and that we would have a uniform distribution of oxygen. So we were quite surprised when we found this. To put this in a perspective of something you could understand, imagine that if you stood up and took a breath in the room that you're sitting there now, if the oxygen was suddenly 10 or 20 or 50% lower, you might get lightheaded. You would find that very strange that the oxygen varied over such a short distance. And yet that's what this instrument told us when we did a saturation here a few years ago at Aquarius. And we're just getting ready to try and publish those results now that we fully understand what's going on. One aspect of the mixing was that we saw in our data what we called kinks in the profile, where the oxygen over a distance of just a foot or so would suddenly drop and then go back up and then drop again and then go back up. It was sort of a double hump. And that double hump has been seen by scientists studying flows in the laboratory, and it's due to the fact that there are eddies that spin only in that bottom couple of meters near the seafloor. And these eddies cause a rapid overturn of the water. And this has some implications for corals themselves. We learned in a previous module yesterday that the flow affects the respiration rate and the photosynthetic rate. And these effects of flow, when combined with these rapid changes in dissolved oxygen, could really have a dramatic effect on how fast the reef is metabolizing over a distance of only a couple of feet. So this is a new direction that we may want to take some future research. Annalise and Phil mentioned that a better way potentially to get a view of the entire flow, the motion in the ocean field, if you will, around Conch Reef would be to put out some acoustic Doppler current profilers and have a huge flux of data into the habitat that could be recorded so that we get a good view of the spatial variability. One other thing that I wanted to mention, now that you've seen how dye mixes, and we'll see it again in a couple minutes on the other side of the habitat, is that the mixing rate changes with time. As you release some dye and start watching it, it mixes slowly at first. You saw that in the dye release. And then as you wait longer and longer amounts of time, you'll see the mixing essentially accelerate. And that's because in the ocean, there are spinning packets of water at a whole host of sizes. In fact, there's a poem that a fluid mechanicist named Richardson wrote about it back in the 1920s. It's in the lesson plan. He said, "Big whirls have smaller whirls that feed on their velocity. Smaller whirls have tinier whirls, and so on to viscosity." What he was saying was that the big eddies, the big spinning packets of water in the ocean, excuse me, break up into smaller eddies, which break up into smaller eddies, which eventually make eddies so small that we wouldn't be able to see them with dye anymore, and that's where the energy of the motion would be dissipated as heat, and that's the viscous shearing effect that we get at the molecular level. So there's essentially a cascade of energy from big eddies down to really tiny eddies that get dissipated as heat. And we can see some of that when we watch the time history of how these dye blobs disperse. Now, if my aquanauts are in position, I don't know if I've given them, I think I've given them enough time. Annalise and Phil, are you on the other side of the habitat now? Describe to me what the bottom type is like there, and why don't you do the dye release again?
On this side of the habitat, we're actually on the coral reef. And the topography is called spur and groove. And this is a typical structure that you often find on the coral reef. Are essentially sand channels, and the spurs are heads of corals sticking out. They run perpendicular to the reef crest. I think our cameraman DJ is taking a little bit of an elevated look at the spur and groove, so you can clearly see the sand channels in amongst the coral reef. Corals grow in this way to dissipate wave energy. So that's good as they act as a barrier to wave energy on shore. Now I've got my meter stick and the dye syringes. And maybe here we'll see a different water movement. Phil, if you could just hold the top of the stick. off itself. There's very little vertical movement. But if we come right into the reef, just a few centimeters above the corals, let's see what happens now.
Thank you very much, Annalise. I wish I was out there to watch this qualitative difference. We're starting to see that the reef is very anisotropic, is the way a scientist would describe it, that we've got very, very different movements in different directions, and that the scale of mixing can change over very short distances. Annalise brought up the concept of a roughness element. Now, if you remember the second slide that we showed with a picture of a house and also the computer animation of the eddies coming off of an obstacle, essentially the whole reef is covered in roughness elements. And the nature of the roughness elements on the upstream side is what determines what the geophysical boundary layer looks like. Now, in an area with sort of uniform roughness, we get what's known as a logarithmic layer. That means that as we move away from a surface, the flow speed increases with the logarithm of the height. That's why we had the stand built with these logarithmically spaced PVC parts. But in the real world, we may not find a well-organized log layer. That's what we found previously using the DO probe. And I'd like to have Phil take a look at what the DO is like there. Phil, remember to rotate the cover so that the flow can go through the sensor before you start your measurements. And why don't you do a quick profile for us there at this new location?
All right, Mark. I'm at the bottom of the logarithmic scale. The first reading is 17.89. I'll start to move up. 17.90. 17.89. Steady at 17.89. Next level, 17.90.
Yes, it's quite an art to holding one's position, making these measurements.
17.92. And I suppose I can't go above the top of the habitat. Is that correct, Mark?
That is correct. Otherwise, we will be yelled at by our minders. Aquarius has an unblemished safety record. So we don't want to do anything that's unsafe in the name of science here. So if you're at the highest you should go, then why don't you stop your readings there? Well, that's very interesting. We've again got a very uniformly mixed layer today. I did do a quick computation, and it looks like the oxygen is a few percent higher over at the location you are now. So oxygen is being put into the boundary layer, most likely by the photosynthetic activity of the algae and even the corals themselves, as well as the sponges, many of whom, as we saw yesterday in the afternoon classroom, have symbiotic algae that can also produce oxygen. You may recall that the large barrel sponge that we looked at yesterday was actually pumping out more oxygen into the boundary layer than was down in the bottom, simply through the byproduct of photosynthesis. So that's very interesting. How does this relate to reef health? Well, if we understand motion in the ocean or over a reef, we've got a couple advantages from a management standpoint. One is if we're trying to predict the dispersal of something like a pollutant, it's going to be very important to understand how fast things mix. If we had an oil spill or a chemical spill near a reef, it'd be nice to know how fast that would dissipate. We don't really have good data on mixing around coral reefs, in part because it's so hard to get them. And Aquarius would make an ideal platform for looking at mixing studies because we'd be able to connect all our flow sensors and data loggers directly to the habitat and really get a nice three-dimensional view of the structure of the flow. Another tool we could use to better understand the mixing would be to swim a robot around the habitat. And I'd like to invite everybody back this afternoon for our afternoon classroom at 2 p.m. We're going to be attempting just such a thing with a free-swimming robot named Fetch. And unfortunately, Fetch does not carry on it an acoustic Doppler current profiler that Phil mentioned earlier in the show. But if it did, that would be a marvelous way to quickly measure the velocities in the boundary layer all around conch reef in a matter of minutes. So we could use this cutting-edge mobile technology that's going to become an increasingly important part of ocean observing systems to measure the mixing around conch reef. Some of the biological reasons we want to know the mixing, of course, are how fast is photosynthesis happening on the reef? How fast is respiration happening at night? The whole ecosystem has a metabolism the same way that individual organisms have a metabolism, like we studied in Classroom 3 and Classroom 4. So by using these tools like you saw today, it will be possible soon to tell the public, a reef manager would be able to go out and measure the reef health by looking at how fast the entire reef is taking up or giving off oxygen. But in order to do that, we're going to have to understand the mixing right near the surface of the corals. So this is new stuff that's been attempted using the habitat. It's still a work in progress. We're glad that you joined us today to see some of these phenomena, some of the physics of motion in the ocean up close and personal. At 2 p.m. this afternoon, we'll be doing a module on Aquarius as an artificial reef, and we're going to see how the fish that hang around the habitat are distributed, and we hope to fly the robot past the habitat and use a kind of a sonar called a side-scan sonar that allows us to image the habitat and the fishes using sound. So if that works, it'll be quite an interesting show. If we have problems with the robot, though, if you like fish, come back anyway, because there's lots of wonderful fish behavior and beautiful fish species that hang out here at America's Inner Space Station, 20,000 millimeters under the sea. So I see that our cameraman, DJ Roller, working for Media Arts, is here, and he's looking in the viewport. So I want to wave goodbye to everybody out there on the internet. Thanks for joining us today. Please visit the Project Sea Camel website at seacamel.livingoceansfoundation.org if you'd like to learn more about what we're doing. And we appreciate everybody saying hi to us. And we'll be back again at 2 p.m. This afternoon, Eastern Standard Time. So long from Aquarius.